At the end of the topic, you will be able to discuss the domestic and foreign policies of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, explain the domestic policies of Mohammed bin Tughlaq, recall the administrative reforms and foreign policies of Firoz Tughlaq, give details of the later Tughlaqs, describe Timur's invasion and the subsequent decline of the Tughlaq dynasty. After the death of Alauddin Khilji, the Khilji dynasty started declining. Soon, the Khilji dynasty came to an end and the Tughlaq dynasty came to power in the Delhi Sultanate. This dynasty was in power from 1320 to 1414 AD. Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, Mohammed bin Tughlaq and Firoz Tughlaq were prominent rulers of this dynasty. Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Ghazi Malik, the governor of Punjab, assisted by a group of nobles, captured Delhi and ascended the throne. He took on the title of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq and established Tughlaq dynasty in 1320 AD. He was an able administrator who rose to the position of a sultan through sheer hard work. Agriculture and irrigation, the judiciary and police, and postal services were given importance during his rule. During his reign, Bengal, Orissa, and Warangal were brought under the control of the Delhi Sultanate. Mongol leaders who invaded northern parts of India during his rule were conquered and put in prison. Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq died in the year 1325 AD. He ruled only for 5 years. His untimely end came when he was crushed to death when the stage he was standing on collapsed at his victory celebrations in Bengal. He was succeeded by his son, Junakkan, the crown prince. Mohammed bin Tughlaq and his domestic policies. When Prince Junakkan became the Sultan of the Delhi Sultanate, he took on the title Mohammed bin Tughlaq. He ruled for 26 years, from 1325 to 1351 AD. He was the second Sultan of the Tughlaq dynasty. He strived for political and administrative unity within India. He imposed heavy taxes on his subjects. People escaped into the forest to avoid taxation. As a result, there was no one to cultivate the land and there was great scarcity for food. Soon, farmers were asked to return and were given loans to start cultivation. Irrigation was improved, yet the people suffered immensely. Mohammed bin Tughlaq changed his capital from Delhi to Devagiri. He did this to protect his capital from the invasions by the Mongols. All government offices and the citizens were also asked to move. Later, they were asked to return to Delhi as Devagiri was unsuitable to be a capital city. These changes caused great misery to the people. Domestic policies. Mohammed bin Tughlaq introduced the use of copper coins. These coins were not minted at a government mint. As they were not minted officially, people started making their own coins. Soon, there was abundance of copper coins and it lost its value. So, Tughlaq stopped the usage of copper currency coins. A mint is an industrial facility which manufactures coins for currency. Tughlaq wanted to capture Iraq, Khorasan and Transoxiana. So, he trained 370,000 men to form an army. When he understood the impossibility of this action, he disbanded the army. In order to pacify the Mongol leader, Tamashirin, from attacking the Sultanate, Tughlaq showered him with expensive gifts. This cost the administration heavily. Mohammed bin Tughlaq was very hasty in making decisions, which eventually failed. This brought about the decline of the Delhi Sultanate. Firoz Tughlaq and administrative reforms. After Mohammed bin Tughlaq's death, Firoz Tughlaq ascended the throne in 1351 AD. He was the son of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq's younger brother. Firoz Tughlaq brought about several reforms that benefited the citizens. Some of the reforms were: he stopped agricultural loans called takwavi that was started by Mohammed bin Tughlaq. Salary of the revenue officers was raised. Unfair taxes were abolished. 4 important taxes were levied. They were karaj, which was 1/10 of the product cultivated; kams, which was 1/5 of the wealth looted during war; jizya poll tax and zakat tax on Muslims for particular religious reasons. Public works was given importance. Firoz Tughlaq built several dams, wells and bridges and dug many irrigational canals. Firozabad, Fatehabad, Janpur and Hisar were built by him. Physical torture as punishment was stopped. Hospitals called Darul Shafa, a marriage bureau called Diwan-e-Khairat and an employment bureau were set up. Another bureau called Diwan-e-Istiqbak was set up to give loans to the needy. He patronized scholars and religious institutes. Madrasa, Institute of Islamic Learning. Madrasa, a leading institution of Islamic learning, was established by Firoz Tughlaq in 1352 in Delhi. It was considered the biggest and best Islamic institute in the world. The madrasa at House Khas became the most significant place in the world for Islamic education. The madrasa was built in L-shape on the edges of a lake. The north-south balconies overlook the lake. From each floor of the madrasa, there are staircases to go down to the lake. Foreign policy and an estimate of Firoz Tughlaq. Firoz Tughlaq attacked Bengal in 1353 and again in 1359 AD. He conquered Jayanagar and demolished the Jagannath temple at Puri. The kings of Nagarkot and Tata were forced to pay tributes. The beneficial reforms of Firoz Tughlaq helped the people of the Sultanate to prosper. Scholars like Ziauddin Barani were patronized. Futuhat-e-Firozshahi was the autobiography of the Sultan. Several Sanskrit books on medicine, science and arts were translated into Persian. One such book was a book on physics titled Kutab-Firozshahi. Firoz Tughlaq's contribution to architecture. Firoz Shah Palace Complex is situated in Hisar in Haryana, India. It was constructed by Firoz Shah Tughlaq in 1354 AD. The Firoz Shah Kotla was a fortress built by Sultan Firoz Tughlaq. One of his hunting lodges, Kushak Mahal, is situated within the Teen Murti Bhavan complex, Delhi. Later Tughlaqs. Firoz Tughlaq was succeeded by rulers who were weak and ineffective. They were Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq II, Abu Bakr Shah, and Nasiruddin Muhammad Tughlaq. Several provinces that were under the control of the Sultanate became independent towards the end of the 14th century. Delhi and Punjab were the only provinces under the control of the Tughlaqs. During the beginning of the 15th century, when the Sultanate of Delhi was still under the Tughlaqs, Timur invaded Delhi in 1414 AD and the Tughlaq dynasty came to an end. Timur's invasion and the end of the Tughlaqs. Timur, the king of Samarkand, was drawn by the immense wealth in Hindustan. During the reign of Nasiruddin Muhammad Tughlaq, Timur attacked Delhi after crossing the river Indus. The Sultan and his prime minister fought back. Timur conquered them and took control of Delhi in 1398. He plundered and killed many and caused great misery. The Tughlaq dynasty soon came to an end and the Sayyid dynasty came to power in the Delhi Sultanate. In this topic you have learnt, Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq established the Tughlaq dynasty in 1320 AD. He was succeeded by Muhammad bin Tughlaq. After Muhammad bin Tughlaq's death, Firoz Tughlaq ascended the throne. He brought about several reforms that benefited the citizens. Firoz Tughlaq attacked Bengal twice and conquered Jayanagar and demolished the Jagannath temple at Puri. Several Sanskrit books on medicine, science and arts were translated into Persian. Firoz Tughlaq was succeeded by rulers who were weak and ineffective. During the beginning of the 15th century, Timur invaded Delhi and defeated the Tughlaq dynasty and the dynasty came to an end in 1414 AD. At the end of the topic, you will be able to explain the rise of the Sayyid dynasty, discuss the rule of the successive sultans of the dynasty, describe the rise and fall of the Lodi dynasty. Timur's invasion in 1398 AD brought about the end of the Tughlaq dynasty. After the decline of the Tughlaq dynasty, the Sayyid dynasty occupied the throne of the Delhi Sultanate. The Sayyid dynasty ruled from 1414 to 1451 AD. They were succeeded by the Lodi dynasty, which ruled from 1451 to 1526 AD. The Delhi Sultanate came to an end after the decline of the Lodi dynasty. Rise of the Sayyid dynasty. After the invasion of Timur, there was unrest in India. Khizr Khan, the governor of Multan, used this opportunity to overthrow the Tughlaqs and ascended the throne. Khizr Khan founded the Sayyid dynasty and ruled from 1414 to 1421 AD. During his reign, Punjab, Dilapur and some portions of Surat came under the control of the Sultanate. Jaunpur, Malwa, Gujarat, Khandesh, Bengal and Deccan were lost during Khizr Khan's rule. Khizr Khan died in 1421 AD and his son Mubarak Shah ascended the throne. Mubarak Shah and Muhammad Shah. Mubarak Shah succeeded Khizr Khan in 1421 AD. He ruled for 13 years. During his reign, the Kokas and local chiefs of the Doab region were brought under the control of the Sultanate. Hindu nobles were appointed in the court at Delhi for the first time. Mubarak Shah constructed Mubarakbad on the banks of Jamuna. He was assassinated in 1434 AD and was succeeded by Mohammad Shah, his nephew. He ruled the Delhi Sultanate for 11 years, from 1434 to 1445 AD. During Mohammad Shah's reign, Malwa was brought under the control of the Sultanate. Bahlol Lodi, who was the governor of Lahore, assisted Mohammad in capturing Malwa. Lodi was given the title Khan-e-Khanan for this. In 1445 AD, Mohammad Shah died and the throne was taken over by Alauddin Shah. End of the Sayyid dynasty. Alauddin Shah ascended the throne after Mohammad Shah. He was a weak ruler and gave up the throne of the Delhi Sultanate to Bahlol Lodi, the governor of Lahore, when Lodi occupied Delhi in 1451 AD. After handing over the throne, Alauddin Shah left for Burdwan and died in 1478 AD. The Sayyid dynasty came to an end and the Lodi dynasty was founded. Lodi dynasty. Bahlol Lodi. Bahlol Lodi established the Lodi dynasty. He was the governor of Lahore when Mohammad Shah was the sultan. Bahlol took advantage of Alauddin Shah, who was a weak ruler, and ascended the throne in 1451 AD. He was the first sultan of the Lodi dynasty. He ruled from 1451 to 1489 AD. He was a clever ruler and took great care to please his nobles. Mewat, Samtal, Etawah and Gwalior were brought under the control of the Sultanate during his rule. Bahlol Lodi died in 1489 AD and was succeeded by his son. Sikandar Shahi. Sikandar Shahi, Bahlol's son, became the Sultan in 1489 AD. He took on the title Sikandar Shah. He was the most powerful Sultan of the Lodi dynasty. He established his empire from Punjab to Bihar. He was a devoted Muslim and restricted Hindus. Sikandar Shah was an able administrator. He set up an effective spice system and improved agriculture and industry. He was a great patron of art, music, literature and architecture. Numerous Sanskrit books on medicine, astronomy, mathematics and yoga were translated to Persian. Lajat-e Sikandar, a book on music, was written during his time. He built the city of Agra. Sikandar Shah died in 1517 AD and was succeeded by his son. End of the Lodi dynasty. Ibrahim Lodi ascended the throne in 1517 AD after his father, Sikandar Lodi's death. He was a harsh ruler. He disgraced his nobles and assassinated some of them. Daulat Khan Lodi was the governor of Lahore. His son, Dilwar Khan, was treated brutally by Ibrahim. To avenge this treatment to his son, Daulat Khan requested Babur, the ruler of Kabul, to attack India. Babur attacked India and conquered Ibrahim Lodi in the First Battle of Panipat in 1526 AD. With the death of Ibrahim Lodi, the Lodi dynasty came to an end. The Lodi dynasty was the last to rule over the Delhi Sultanate. Babur ascended the throne after the death of Ibrahim Lodi and established the Mughal Empire in India. First Battle of Panipat. First Battle of Panipat was fought between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi in 1526. It marked the beginning of the Mughal Empire. The Mughal army of Babur, the Timurid ruler of Kabul, conquered the much larger army of Ibrahim Lodi, the Sultan of Delhi. The battle was fought near the small village of Panipat in present-day Haryana. It was the first battle in which field weaponry was used. In this topic, you have learnt: the Sayyid dynasty ruled over Delhi Sultanate from 1414 to 1451 AD. Khizr Khan, who was the founder of the Sayyid dynasty. Mubarak Shah succeeded Khizr Khan in 1421 AD. He was succeeded by Mohammad Shah, his nephew. Alauddin Shah ascended the throne after Mohammad Shah. He gave up the throne to Bahlol Lodi and the Lodi dynasty was founded. Ibrahim Lodi ascended the throne in 1517 AD after Sikandar. He disgraced his nobles and assassinated some of them. Babur attacked India and conquered Ibrahim Lodi in the First Battle of Panipat in 1526 AD. The Lodi dynasty, the last to rule over the Delhi Sultanate, came to an end and the Mughal Empire was established in India. At the end of the topic, you will be able to discuss the administrative system of the Delhi Sultanate, understand the social and economic conditions of the people during that period, appreciate the architectural and literary contributions of the Sultanate. The Sultanate of Delhi lasted for 320 years, from 1206 to 1526 AD. It was a theocratic and a military state. Theocracy is a form of government in which God is recognized as the supreme ruler. The Sultanate was ruled according to the dictates of Islamic laws. The contribution of the sultans to art and architecture was immense. Their architecture was a combination of Indian and Islamic styles. The decline of the Sultanate started with the invasion of Timur during the rule of the Tughlaq dynasty. Central administration. The empire was headed by the Sultan. He had immense powers over his empire. Six ministers were appointed to help him in administering the empire. There were also several other officials who helped in the administration. Provincial and local administration. The empire was centrally administered by the Sultan and his six ministers. For easy administration, the empire was divided into numerous iktas. The iktas were headed by iktadas or governors. Iktas were further divided into shiks, parganas and villages. The shiks were headed by shikdas. The parganas were headed by munsifs known as amils, treasurers and quanangos. The iktas, shiks and parganas were classified under provincial administration. The villages were controlled by the panchayat and was the smallest unit in the administration. Local hereditary officers also assisted the panchayats in running the villages. Education, sanitation, justice and revenue were the departments administered by the panchayats. The villages were classified under the local administration. The central administration did not intervene in the local administration. Revenue, judicial and military administration. Revenue administration. The main source of income for the empire was land revenue. To increase revenue, agriculture and irrigation were given importance. House tax, trade tax, mines tax and horse tax were some of the taxes collected from the people. Judicial administration. The highest judicial power was the Sultan. The Sultan was assisted by Qazi-ul-Quzar, the Minister of Justice. A Qazi was appointed in every town to maintain law and order. Criminals were punished severely. Military administration. The commander of the army was the Sultan. The army was divided into four units. Royal, provincial, feudal and wartime army were the divisions. Social and economic conditions. During the Sultanate period, the people were classified as Muslims, Indian Muslims and Hindus. The main economic activity during this period was agriculture and industry. Some of the industries were textile industry, sugar industry, paper industry, metal works, stone cutting, pearl diving, ivory and sandal works. The textile industry was well developed as there was great demand for Indian textiles in other countries. Bengal and Gujarat produced excellent fabrics. Silk and cotton textiles were produced in huge quantities. Gold, diamonds, pearls, silver and stones were used to decorate the clothes. Architecture during the Sultanate period. All the sultans contributed immensely to art and architecture. The architecture during this period represented three styles, namely the Delhi or imperial style, the provincial style and the Hindu architectural style. All the dynasties made their contributions. Mamluk period. The famous Qutub Minar was started by Qutbuddin Aibek and completed by Iltutmish. It is the tallest brick minaret in the world. The Quatul Islam Mosque and the tombs of Nasiruddin Mohammed and Balbin were constructed during this period. Khilji period. The Alai Darwaza and Dargah of Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya was constructed during the Khilji period. The Alai Darwaza is the main gateway to the Qutub complex. It was built by Alauddin Khilji. Tughlaq period. During this period, the buildings were solid and strong and were not very decorative. Some of the buildings had resemblance to Hindu architecture. The famous monuments of this period were the Adalabad Fort and the palace and tomb of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. The cities of Tughlaqabad and Jahanpana are examples of architectural excellence during this period. Lodi period. The renowned Lodi Gardens and the Moti Masjid in Delhi was constructed during the rule of the Lodi dynasty. The tomb of Sikandar Lodi was also constructed during this period. Architecture during the Sultanate period: Qutub Minar, Qutub Complex, Quwatul Islam Mosque, Balban's tomb in Mehrauli, Alai Darwasa, Siri Fort, Ghiyas al-Din Tughlaq's tomb in Delhi, Adalabad Fort, Lodi Gardens, Sikandar Lodi's tomb. Literature. Scholars were patronized during the Sultanate period. Al-Biruni, Amir Khusrau, and Ziaul-ul-Barani were some of the scholars who were honored. Many Sanskrit books were translated into Arabic. It was during this period that Urdu language originated. Scholars of the Sultanate period. Al-Biruni was an Arabic and Persian scholar. He was proficient in Sanskrit and translated some Sanskrit books into Arabic. The Upanishads and Bhagavad Gita greatly impressed him. He refers to the socio-economic conditions in India in his book Tariqul Hind. Amir Khusrau was a famous Persian poet. He has composed more than 4 lakh small poems comprising 2 lines like the Tirukural. He was also a great singer and was called the Parrot of India. Khusrau used Hindi words in his poems. Turkish invasion into India brought about many changes. They were: a centralized political organization was established. Contacts with other countries in Asia and some countries in Africa were revived. A permanent army was set up. The introduction of a uniform legal system, tax regulations and currency improved trade. Persian was made the court language and this resulted in a common administration. Decline of the Delhi Sultanate. The Delhi Sultanate started declining during the reign of the Tughlaqs. Timur's invasion led to further decline. Sultans of the Sa'id and Lodi dynasties were ineffective and weak. The Vijayanagar and Bahmani kingdoms became independent of the Sultanate. Khandesh, Bengal, Sindh, Multan, Gujarat, Malwa, Jaunpur, Kashmir, Assam and Orissa soon established their independence. The first battle of Panipat in 1526 AD saw the end of the Delhi Sultanate. The Delhi Sultanate was in power for about 300 years from 1206 to 1526 AD and was succeeded by the Mughal Empire. Succession broke out between his sons after his death in 1308 AD. After the death of Maravarman Kulasekara I, a war of succession broke out between his sons Sundara Pandian and Veera Pandian. Sundara Pandya was able to ascend the throne with the help of Malik Kafir, the commander of Alauddin Khilji. The Khilji dynasty was succeeded by the Tughlaq dynasty, which had a strong hold in South India. They made the Pandya region a part of their empire. The Sultans of Madurai established themselves after the decline of the Tughlaqs. The Pandya Empire completely declined after this. In this topic you have learnt, the history of the Pandyas is divided into 3 phases: the early Pandyas, first Pandya Empire and second Pandya Empire. During the last part of the 6th century AD, Kadungun, the Pandya king, overthrew the Kalabras and restored the Pandya kingdom. The Pandyas reasserted their independence from the Cholas during the 13th century. Vikrama Pandya became the ruler with the help of Kulothunga III. The Pandya Empire completely declined when the Sultans of Madurai established themselves. At the end of the topic, you will be able to understand the pattern of Pandyan administration, analyze their contribution to literature, art and architecture, appreciate their painting skills. The Pandya Mandalam or Pandya Empire was divided into Valanadu and Urs. The Aryans or ministers and their army chief assisted the king in administration. There were special offices for maintaining accounts and for collection of taxes. Local self-government. The village administration was carried on by 5 variams. They were Nidhi Variam, Varitandal Variam, Nanaya Variam, Neer Nilay Variam and Arunilaya Variam. Occupation. The main occupation of Pandya society was agriculture and trade. The agriculturalists were termed as Bhumi Putiras. There were slaves in the Pandya dynasty who performed different tasks. Pearl diving was one of the important occupations of the Pandyas. The pearls of the Pandya kingdom were world famous. Korkai and Tondi were the famous ports of the Pandyas. The Pandya kings encouraged the growth of literature. Some of the famous literary works of this period are Thiruvasagam, written by Manika Vasagar, Thirupavai, written by Andal, Thirupalandu, written by Nammalvar, Mahabharata, written by Villiputrar, Naidadam, written by Adi Veera Rama Pandya, Sayur Murugam Ula and Ratangiri Ula, written by Sri Kavya Raya. The Pandyas made valuable contribution in the field of art and architecture. The gateways, gopuras, prakaras, garbhagrahas, and vimanas were the special features of the Pandya temple architecture. It was a period of reawakening of rock-cut temples. The Pandya temples are found in Kunnakudi, Annaimalai, Kalugumalai, Tiruparankundram, Trichurapalli, Malayadi Kurchi, and Sitanavasal. There are about 50 rock-cut temples found in these places. Structural temples of Pandya style are found in Tirupattur, Madurai, Srivilliputtur, Kovilpatti, and few other places. Artha Mandapa, Mani Mandapa, and Sanati were built in all the temples during the time of Kulasekaran Pandya. These Sabha Mandapas served as places of social gathering, religious kirtanas, recitals, public meetings, and Kadanataka. The Pandya sculptures are noted for its beauty and ornamentation. The best specimens of this period are Ganapati, Somaskandar, Narasimha, Natraja, and Durga. The sculptures of the Pandya period are found in Kunnakudi, Nartamalai, Tirumalaipuram, Tiruparankundram, and Kalugumalai. The Pandya emperors gave a lot of importance to painting. The Sitanavasal cave temples display mural paintings of Srimaran Sri Vallabha Pandya of the first Pandya empire. The other famous paintings include playing fish, lotus, and bathing elephant. Thus, the Pandyas have made immense contribution to South India.